to the one thing we struggled last year. We committed too much. We committed that we will have a practice at Love Park Tuesday and Thursday, and then it all fell in at Fridays. And it was hard because we didn't have enough coaches to cover. So it was a big toll on a couple of us to go Tuesday, Thursday, Love Park, and Friday over there. But there are a few coaches that we added. The journey begins, they saw the struggles. And help came from unexpected quarters. And some of the parents who were as Tom was, you know, we used to watch from the side, and we got them in, that the commitment is such that, again, that these are the people, they are the people who are we calling it as core coaches, who are making things happen for us. So now I feel confident when we take the load that we have enough coaches. The Friday sessions, now we look at it, it's just awesome feeling. You know, there is nobody, one person is completely under pressure. There is a load is very well distributed, and we are able to make things happen. And I think that would not happen without the addition of Tom and two other people I'm going to call. First, Raj and family, Sophia and Raj, please. Big thanks for all of that. Sophia.
This is to want you to be part of the family.
Oh, that was speech. All right, complete surprise. You know, Ganesh and I used to play cricket like, you know, years ago, and then I always wanted the kids to go join, but they never did. But all of a sudden, like a few months back, back in 2016, they did, and through them, I'm now getting back into cricket, and I enjoy it, love it, and you know, this is too much, buddy, but you know, I want to say that I love it, and I want to continue doing this.
Thank you. If you see Raj in the nets and coaching, Raj will not be complete if there is another person who works as hard as us, and he just does it without knowing that he's there. Wish, Jay, if you can join us. Jay is the one. We are really looking forward to take these few things here, what we are learning, to get to the kids. She has done a tremendous job with our events. So thanks, Jay.
Everyone, thanks, Ajay, for that wonderful thing. I love cricket. Definitely, I want to contribute my wholehearted contribution to all the kids to help them to improve their game. Thank you very much.
I'm actually very, very proud of what this entire team has done, starting from very small to where we have grown. It makes me extremely proud, especially given from where we are, and we are in a country that didn't know about cricket but now knows about it. So it's a great feeling. I'm actually trying to get my co-workers to come in and play with us, and hopefully this summer we'll get them and we'll introduce them to our wonderful sport of cricket. But it's great to be a part of this family. Thank you.
I think Vivek came on the stage. Most of you know who Vivek is, so I'm going to introduce Vivek, which I should have done it earlier. So Vivek is, should I say Vivek, or you want to do it? So Vivek, for me, people call him like he's the guy who you need to know in St. Louis if you need to have a network. You know, he's the guy you should know. He knows everyone. He'll make things happen. For me, Vivek is a friend. I just call him. If people take appointments to meet him, I just call him to see whenever I need help. He's an attorney, local attorney with a lot of good heart. And he's always there for us. So for us, he's part of the family. He's in a WhatsApp group and he reads those messages. That's crazy. But he never complains. You know, there are some some crazy messages we get over there. So, but it's fun to have. It's really, it feels really good to have that such a strong team. And there are people who are not even involved directly with cricket, but helping us out to shape up this academy, shape up this organization in a very, very different ways. So really, really proud of having association with Vivek. Thanks.
I don't know if I deserve them or not, but thank you again. I think this has been a great journey that you started. I joined in between when you started this journey. But where it has reached today, it's commendable. I am really, really proud of the whole organization. And I am also proud of myself that I am connected with it. I think in the coming days and the months and the years, we'll also take this movement up to the legislature to have this sport and our efforts recognized by the state as well. And I'm working in that direction. So again, the actions should be more powerful than words. So when that happens, I think that will be the moment to cherish. But we'll see how it goes. But thank you again for inviting me. Thank you again, Ajay. Thank you, Lisa.
So our next speaker is Mr. Peter Dry. Everybody knows Peter. I think he's not coaching kids in winter, but he's always there in summer sessions. And it just gives me a confidence when then I get a call from him that we are doing right. Because he has coached it for over 22 years. In different, I think in almost every continent. So it gives me a lot of confidence when he calls me and said, yes, that's how it should be. When I'm coaching, especially a game, whether we were in California, whether we were in Atlanta, when he's around, and to get the different perspective, when I can go and talk to him saying, this is what I'm thinking, that's what we need to do for this game. And it gives me that confidence that we are heading in the right direction. So to have him here within us to share his experiences today, this is going to be big, and this is the moment we were waiting for. We were planning for like last 6-8 months, so finally it's here. So it's Peter. Here
you go. Well, thank you very much. Thanks for inviting me, and thanks for making it happen, Ganesh, as well. Much appreciated. It's very humbling for me to be standing here. I understand I have 20-something years of experience in cricket, in coaching, and in dealing with good kids. That's one of the areas of expertise that I don't have many areas, but that's one of them is with kids and how to coach them, how to get an idea through to them. And I have a deep love for children and their growth, and a deep love of cricket and for cricket. And that's why the conversations that I have with all of you around cricket is, feel like I'm at home. I mean, it's just a beautiful feeling in a country that I sometimes feel very, that I really am a foreigner. But with this family, I do feel very much very different. So I thank you. I'm very aware that I'm not the best cricket coach in the room. I've seen enough of you coaching, and I'm very aware of that. So this is not a time of me to say, hey, this is how to coach. I'm going to be sharing with you some ideas that I've learned from different people over the years, people that I've been lucky enough to work with, and I've contacted them especially to give some ideas about this session. And then also sharing amongst all of you, because you all have such rich stories to tell. All of you have got coaching stories, you've got coaching ideas, you're good coaches and excellent coaches in your own right. And I want to acknowledge that today. So this really isn't, you know, this is not going to be a speech. You guys and ladies are actually going to be working. That's why there's pens and paper and all sorts of things there. You're going to be sharing stories and building an understanding of what good coaching is about. And that's really the vision of AJ and Ganesh, is as we move through these years of building this club, how do we start to build a common understanding of what good coaching looks like? So just very quickly, going to a different sport, going to rugby. I don't know if any of you have read the book Legacy. It's a book about the All Blacks. And it's an outstanding book, and I highly recommend that you read it. It's called Legacy by James Kerr. And what Kerr does, he says, he looks at the All Black rugby team, who's got an 86% winning record. It's the most, it's the best team that the planet has ever known. It's got the best winning record of any team in the professional era. How do they do that? I don't know if you know how many people New Zealand have got in there living in the, I mean, they've got more sheep than people, okay? Like 6 million people. 3 million are female. Maybe some of those other million don't play rugby. So you've got this tiny population on this tiny island, and for year after year after year, they've dominated world rugby. How do they do that? And the book really is a book about culture. And that's what I love, and I keep saying to us, I think I said to you guys on the phone the other night, that's what I love about this club. It's culture first. What kind of culture are we creating for our kids, for the adults, for the community? And this, and so Kerr looks at the culture of the All Blacks, and he says, that's why they win. And within the culture, there's this common language and this common approach to coaching cricket, to coaching rugby rather. And because coaches, whether they're coaching under 9 C team, or whether they're coaching the professional team, they all have the same understanding around coaching. They all are building the same kind of culture, and they have the same kind of a language of coaching. They structure their practices the same way. They have the same kind of expectations of players. So that means that wherever you go as a player, you're hearing the same things. The same expectations are there. And so they've got this incredibly strong culture that no one can beat. So this is what we will be, I would say in a few years' time, ACA will publish their own book on cricket coaching. There will be a manual that a coach can get and says, look, here's the skeleton. You can bring your own personality to the coaching sessions, but this is what we expect because we're trying to create a particular culture. So this is part of that. It's really opening up a discussion with that. So I hope you are going to walk away with some specific coaching techniques. I'm not going to teach you how to hold a cricket bat or to bowl an away swinger or bowl a googly. That's for another day. And I'm probably not the guy to teach you how to bowl a googly anyway. But what we are going to do is think about what's the attitude that we bring to cricket coaching. And I'll leave you with some practical tips around how to get information across to younger players in particular. So for now, what I'd like you to do, because I promised this wasn't going to be a speech, what I'd like you to do is think to yourself, what is your earliest cricketing memory? So some of you, that's easy because it's like 5 years ago, okay? Some of you are going all the way back. So it doesn't matter who you are in this room. Somebody has, you haven't the earliest cricketing memory. So just think for a moment what that is. Don't share it. Just think about what that is. So just think, what is my earliest cricketing memory? Right. So hopefully you've got something in your head. All right, what I'd like you to do then in a moment is to stand up, and you're just going to walk around. And as you walk up to someone, you look them in the eye, and you go, stop, and share that cricketing memory. Once you've shared, go and find someone else. Look them in the eye. Oh, okay. If someone looks you in the eye, don't ignore them, okay? We don't do flybys here. No flybys. So we're literally going to spend about 2 or 3 minutes sharing cricketing stories. So up you get, walk around, find someone from another table, look them in the eye, quickly share a story, and then find someone else. Off you go. Your earliest cricketing memory. Stand up. Ladies, you've got a cricketing memory as well. Stand up and be part of this as well. And then share it, everybody.
Oh, nice.
Stand up. Chairs and look, and there are quality people in this room who've got amazing memories and amazing wisdom to share. So really get engaged with it. The more you put in, the more you're going to get out of the session. Next thing for the next 3 minutes, what's your best cricketing memory? Not your earliest, but your best. Something when you think about that cricketing, you just maybe it was that that cover drive that you just, you know, AJ bowled to you, a little just moving away, a little high ball. You just said, thank you very much, I'll take that. Or it was a great catch. Or maybe it was watching your son or your daughter scoring. Or maybe it was just a coaching moment that you had, or an Indian victory. Or what's your best cricketing memory? So 3 minutes with that. Off you go. Stand up, walk around, have a conversation. Best cricketing memory.
What is your best?
Who would like to share?
Oh, okay. I have a nomination.
Go for it.
Yeah, that was the best.
This was actually one of the best cricketing memories is when India won the World Cup for the first time in 1983. It has its own tense moments but also funny moments, because we as a family were like glued to the television. We were kind of almost lost hope, but my mom she is a very big cricket fan, so she kind of prayed to Lord Ganesha saying that she would burst 51 coconuts. Year one, and she did it, but it was one of the most rewarding matches that I've ever seen, and I still, it's very fresh in my mind. So
what a great story. Thank you very much. Anyone else with an earliest or best cricketing memory who would like to share? Let's have a couple more. Suddenly everyone's super shy now. Ganesh?
Yes, sir. I was not a super cricketer when I was saying I was an average cricketer, and our team was not the best of the team either, and we were playing against one of the top quality team where we never had a chance. On that day, I was the last, well, I was not a top order, I was somewhere in the middle order. I didn't have any people batting with me, so the target was stiff. And lo and behold, I was able to take my team to the victory stage, and was able to that transform me into a cricketer, and made me to play from that point a little seriously, that I do have some talent in, with me to knock or bowl the ball. So that was my first
fantastic. Yeah, and those give him a round of applause. Thank you. Those moments of realization that you can actually play the game and to come through those tough moments. What a great story. Let's have one more. Best or earliest cricketing memory. It was like, yes.
So I was a kid and I was in fourth grade, I guess. So the cricket was part of our PE activity. So we were having a co-ed game, like, you know, boys and girls. So I was batting and I kind of, you know, made a boy, you know, on the other side run out. the whole team, you know, the cheering team was very mad at me because that boy was supposed to be very, you know, one of the best players, and I made him run out. So yeah, that is something that always, you know.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I remember a story like that. I was playing for a cricket team in England. I just finished a season of field hockey, and we it was a Premier League team that I'd been playing. It was fantastic. We travelled all around the country and around Wales every weekend playing this team. And then one day in the pub, one of the gentlemen said to me, he wasn't part of the team, he said, "You South African, you must be able to play cricket." I said, "Yeah, I can. I'm all right. I can play cricket." He said, "Well, come and join us." Anyway, a few weeks later, we're playing the first game, and he said, "Look, our opener isn't here. Will you open the batting? I'm a terrible opener. I don't have great defense." And he said, "Well, just we really need you to open the batting." I said, "All right, I'll come along." And first ball I faced, it was the first ball of the brand new season. The captain, who'd invited me to be on the team, was standing opposite me. And I pushed one, easy single. I thought, I ran through. And as I got there, I realized he was still there. And so I ran out, the captain of the first game, without scoring a run, without facing a ball. Very embarrassing moment. So what it does mean is you make sure you stay out in the middle for a long time so that he settles down, you know. But what I realized, he was the slowest man I'd ever played cricket with. So it was really very, no, we'll just wait here. But some great memories, and cricket's a beautiful game. I was going to ask you for your worst memory, but that's an easy one.
Sorry.
take that off. Maybe that's a bit happier. Huh? All right. So this is a man that coached me for several years. He actually coached me field hockey, Mike Beshe. He's actually coached several international players, and he's also coached 19 South African hockey players have gone through his hands as a coach. He also coached the South African under-19 team when they won the World Cup. So he's an outstanding coach. And I gave him a call to say, you know, what advice would he give us as coaches? But first of all, let's see how good you are. These are some of his people.
John Peterson.
Kevin
Peterson.
Miller.
Yes, David Miller. Well done. Yeah, David Miller. Lefty like Klusner. It does actually look very much like Klusner. Funny enough, Klusner was from the same area. He was at a competing school from where Beshe coached Lance Klusner. Yeah. So this is what Beshe said to me. 21. There we go. That's a bit about Mike Beshe. So this man knows how to coach kids. That's basically what it says up there. This is what he says. He talks about passion, the key quality. And Ganesh, I can make these available for you as well. He talks about the two C's of commitment and being consistent to the players. He's very, very disciplined. He was definitely one of the toughest coaches that I ever had. We were always fitter than the other team. If we weren't better than them, we were always fitter than them. He loves what he does. He said his approach to hockey, to cricket and hockey, is very simple. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more later. It's very, very simple. Cricket's a tough game. And for little guys and girls to tell them, you know, about the intricacies of how they should hold a bat and how they should play a cut shot and how they should play a flick off the leg, I mean, this is hard work. When all we should really be saying is, see ball, hit ball. See ball, hit ball. That's really it. Honestly, from a young age, just see the ball, hit the ball. I don't care where your leg is. Typically, if you can hit the ball, your leg's going to be fairly close. But see ball, hit ball. I mean, so he was very, very simple in the way that he approached the game. And this is where he speaks about the conditioning as well. And that's something that we do have to consider for our kids. Our kids are growing up differently to how we grew up. We probably walk to school. We probably cycle to school. Yeah, everyone's going, yeah. Here, I live not 300 meters from the school building, and my kids are horrified when I don't take them to school in the morning. Horrified, what do you mean? What do you mean you're going to school late? What do you mean you know, can't believe it? So they just don't spend it, and technology has played a huge impact. And that's why we're seeing kids with so many more injuries now than ever before. They're just simply not conditioned. We lived a different lifestyle. We didn't have technology. So what did we do? We either read a book or we went outside. So we had a lot more muscle developed, and these kids just don't have that. The amount of PE that's in schools now is minimal too. We simply just don't have that. I would say in some ways the quality of coaching has diminished, so the coaches aren't aware of how to look after your bodies. So the conditioning was really, really important. And he talks about this, play the music in front of them. That's the very, that's Mike Bechet's simple approach. Not to think too much about it. What do you see in front of you? Play according to that. Don't overthink. One of the guys that he coached was a friend of mine called, and I think I've told AJ the story, called Roan Lyle. Now, Roan was a 6'9", and he opened the bowling for Natal. And he was very excited. I shared an apartment with him. He was very excited because the next day, Malcolm Marshall was joining the team. So you guys all remember Malcolm Marshall? You know, bowling like that. You didn't see it. So Malcolm Marshall was joining the team. And he was, we called this guy Yeti because he looked like the Yeti, you know. He had big feet and very tall. So Yeti was super excited. He said, I've got all these questions I'm going to ask Malcolm Marshall. They called him Macca. I'm going to ask Macca this. And so he was really excited. Now, the problem with Yeti, he was too intelligent. You know, he was doing a Bachelor of, I don't know, economics or something at university, and then he did his master's. A very smart guy. Too smart to be a fast bowler, basically. He kept, in the first season of being professional, he kept apologizing to people when he bounced them. He'd run up and say, I'm sorry. So we try to get that out of him. Anyway, Macca gets to the training next day, speaks to him. Anyway, he comes back that evening. I said, how was it? How did your conversation go with Malcolm Marshall? He goes, it was really strange because I went up to him and I said, Macca, you know, it's great to have you here. And what I want to know is I just want to know how I can just bring that ball in and at the last minute just get it to seam away. And then I want to be able to keep bowl one that just stays nice and straight. And he had all these, and Macca just looked at him and said, am I? Just bowl fast. So, you know, if players of that level and that caliber can keep the game that simple, let's think about that as coaches. How can we as coaches keep the game simple for our little guys and girls? Because we want them to love the game, but how can we keep it simple for them? And that's really what he says here. What's in front of you? Don't overthink the thinking. If the ball's pitched up, drive it. If it's short, pull it. There you go. There's the two shots. Drive it if it's pitched up, pull it if it's short. For the little guys, that's how he coached. It was as simple as that. Bowling a cricket ball, just see those wickets, just aim for those wickets. If it's too short and too full, it's okay. Just bowl nice and straight. That's all it is. Nothing too difficult. So just to keep it simple for the kids. One of our challenges is adults, because we know the game at this level, we try and we want our kids to learn all of that really, really quickly. We don't have to do that, and I'll talk more about that later. He calls this teacup. Think clearly under pressure. Teacup. So I want you to think about that. How do we train our kids to think clearly under pressure? I mean, when we go to California, I mean, those kids, you know, it's all very nice here, but man, they're going to play some of those players. There's enormous pressure out there. I mean, I felt it. I felt it. I'm not proud of my behavior on the last day. You know? They were wrong, by the way. They were definitely wrong. I'll check that out this again, because I still wake up with, Anyway, it's just a game. I can't remember that. So think clearly under pressure. How do we get students to do that? How do we get our little kids to think clearly under pressure? So have a conversation at your table about that. How can I set up my coaching to have them practice thinking clearly under pressure? So I'll just give you 3 minutes. At your table, discuss what does that look like in a coaching session. Okay, go for it. And then we'll report back in 3 minutes.
Like, don't overthink and kind of
give them like what people say.
You know, sometimes you have all this imagination, then you don't have a playbook and it's not working out, then it's going to be complicated. Have a simplistic view. You should be able to change the condition of the game changes from that.
Exactly. Yeah, view the condition of the game. I mean, maybe you have to score 50 runs. Okay, think on the physical. And think on the condition.
Here we go.
I think the main thing in pressure, if kids play more under pressure, they'll tend to make more mistakes.
Uh-huh.
What I see is like, if you play a game, whatever the crucial point, just enjoy the game. You enjoy the game, best thing will come out. And there will be definitely a learning lesson, whether you win, you lose, doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Let them enjoy the game, automatically they'll learn on their own mistakes. So
yeah,
that's, I followed from my childhood, and it makes results, not in cricket, but outside too.
Yeah, I think that's really clear, is that if you enjoy the game, you're better under pressure. The kids will put themselves under enough pressure. They know the deal. There's no kid who wants to go out there and lose a game, or bowl the wide, or get bowled first ball. They really don't. So they are probably putting themselves under enough pressure already. So I think that's a really good point. Anything else? How can we maybe structure a training session to help them really think clearly under pressure?
One of the drills that I help the boys do is trying to keep it simple. The simple KISS principle, keep it simple, stupid.
Yep.
So don't complicate it. Nobody wants to get out. The exercise is 4 wickets facing north, south, east, west, right next to each other.
Yeah.
4 coaches ready with the ball.
Yeah.
The bat's on the ground. The moment you say start, kid picks up the bat. Even before he picks up the bat, the first ball's thrown. Okay, all he has to do is prevent the ball hitting the wicket. That's it.
Yep.
Every coach is half pitch away. So just one step, one bounce, it's coming straight for the wicket. So he doesn't have to overanalyze where do I hit, front foot, back foot. Just grab the bat and hit the ball and prevent getting out. That's it. The moment he does the first one, he doesn't have enough time to go to the second ball's already thrown.
Yeah.
So that way, he has to keep running from north, south, east, west. Wickets are back to back each other.
Yeah.
That's it. Just try and prevent getting out.
Yeah.
So So they learn bat speed, they learn fast hands, the hand-eye coordination, and stuff like that.
Yeah, that's awesome. And that's it. That's exactly the point, is that creating a high-pressure moment so that even if it's something that wouldn't really happen in a game, but that high-pressure moment when they've got to pick up, they've got to react quickly, they've got to react quickly. So that's getting them used to, instead of what can happen is like everything's really casual and I can just do whatever and doesn't matter and, you know. But if it's a competition and it's high pressure, that helps them to start to think under pressure. Absolutely. So how do you create, and we won't go into these details now, maybe another time, but these high-intensity stations where the kids are having to think quickly as opposed to really just relaxing. And mostly, the reason why kids play sports is they enjoy competition. So it's not a difficult thing to create for kids. They really enjoy it. So yeah, think about whatever station you have, how can you put them under a little bit of pressure so that the senses are heightened? There's something in psychology that's called a state of relaxed anxiety. Relaxed anxiety. That is the best state to learn something. Not too relaxed, not too stressed out. A state of relaxed anxiety. And remember, it's going to be different for every child. And that's why, as coaches, we've got to be thinking about that. Another thing to do here, and you hear this is happening more and more with T20. As much as I used to dislike T20, it's the innovations have been remarkable. But speaking to Beshe, when a player, you guys would have been aware of this as well, when a player comes in into the nets or they have a practice out in the middle, the coach puts a scenario in front of them. The scenario is, there are two balls left in the innings and you've just gone in. That's the scenario. Or for another game, here's the bowler. Bowler, there's six balls left, they've got 10 runs to win. You tell the bowlers that, you tell the batsmen that. Put them under game pressure, so they're thinking about the game all the time. What about this? You've got to bowl three dot balls in a row. It's a limited overs game, you've got to bowl three dot balls in a row. Batsmen, you've got three more balls, you need to hit at least one boundary. Keep putting, so they're thinking about what kind of shots they should play, how they should bowl, instead of just running up and bowling a ball or just hitting a shot. Put them in those game situations, putting them under a little bit of pressure is really, really useful. Does that make sense? So teacup, I think, is an important takeaway. Here we go. This guy coached me as well in South Africa. This is quite unusual because even though he's South African, these three South Africans don't play for South Africa. So Denzel coached, he coached a number of provincial and international players. That is? He broke South Africa's hearts.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah.
He went to the same school as me, Grant Elliott. Grant Elliott. Yeah. Really good all-rounder. He was still playing at the age of 36. I mean, it was remarkable. Yeah. Good, and a fantastic guy as well. Geez, this lets you, well, you know your cricket here. He plays for Holland. I don't know how many cricketers you know for Holland. I was at school with him as well, actually. Billy Stelling. Very good all-rounder. Hated facing him in the nets. He nearly killed me. I was petrified of him. And naughty, eh? Naughty. I don't know how he got expelled from one school and ended up at our school. But very good rugby player as well. But, geez, he could not behave himself at all. England cricketer. Michael Love. So Denzel coached these and many others. Denzel is a very different coach to Mike Beshe. Beshe is intense. He uses pretty bad language. I learnt a lot of language from Mike Beshe. Denzel, on the other hand, very passionate, but a very softly spoken man. Fantastic guy. Sorry, there's a lot of writing here, but I'll just go through it quickly. And I'll get to some of the key points here. But valuing each team member. That's what Denzel was outstanding at this. He really wanted to know each of his players. He knew what you were doing at school. He knew your subjects. He asked you questions about yourself. What I loved about him was that he made us feel like people and then players. So he really wanted to know who we were. So he really valued us and wanted to know how we could contribute. He tells a great story here of encouraging your players to try new things. Do you remember the guy, the umpire, Dickie Bird? Okay, so Dickie Bird actually coached a lot of cricket in South Africa. And there were two, there were the Jennings brothers, Pat and Ray Jennings. I don't know if anyone remembers Ray Jennings. Okay, wicketkeeper. All right, he was never a wicketkeeper. He was a really good fast medium bowler, could swing the ball like crazy. But at practice, he just kept saying, I want to play wicketkeeper. And now here's Dickie Bird saying his best bowler in the team, now was a going to play wicketkeeper, are you kidding me? But Dickie Bird was great at allowing players to try new things. I want to be a spin bowler, I want to be a fast bowler. And he would just allow this to happen at training. And Ray Jennings became one of the best wicketkeepers that South Africa ever had. So think about that. Rather let them try new things at the training than on the when we're playing a team from California. Okay. Know your players' strengths and weaknesses. Know what works for them. Right, if we know that there's a player who's not a good close in fielder, that before he sees it, he'll probably wear it, you know? So put them in positions where they can feel successful. Build on their strengths is far more important than building on their weaknesses. And Kali Charan said that. I was concerned about, you know, Tane, because Tane will cut anything. First ball, if it's close to him or far, he's got like Indian wrists, you know, likes to, I don't know where he gets it from, but he likes to cut. And I said to Kali Charan, what's the deal? You're like, he knows that. I mean, I was told just don't cut. Just don't cut, okay? And Kali Charan's like, no, it's his strength. Encourage it. Oh, okay. Completely different approach. Operating from the strengths, which I really thought was quite interesting. Never stop encouraging. I think that's something that we do very well as a club. Just with this, a really key point, and again, this is the psychology around children, and I guess it's around when we're leading in business as well. But when we encourage and give feedback, it needs to be specific. Good job isn't helpful. In fact, good job starts to wear away and the child doesn't hear it anymore. Now, I know in an American society, good job is something we hear all the time. Good job! Good job! But it actually doesn't help. What does help is being specific. I like the way you formed a barrier with your legs. Ah, next time, form a barrier. Because when we're the little kids, good job, they, I don't know, what did I do? Good job. I don't know what I did, but if you give, I like the way you formed the barrier. Hey, you know when you caught that ball, I love the way you got your fingers together. Or I love the way it was really good the way you were calling between wickets. Did you notice how that helped the other batsman? So when you start to give that specific feedback, that's where the learning takes place. So specific feedback when encouraging a player is really, really important. The learning goes through the roof. We said keep it simple, stupid, keep it simple, Simon. There we go. Denzel says the same thing. When coaching young kids, keep it simple. They've got many, many years to learn the game. Mm-hmm. Keep it simple. Respect your players. We know that as well. When the going gets tough, let's encourage them. What I love about this club is there's an element of tough love. My son needs it. And I'm sure most of our sons and daughters need it. But the element of tough love, there's respect in the tough love. If your child ran across a road, a busy road, you wouldn't say, oh, don't worry, sweetie, that was fine. No, because it's not loving. They're not learning from that. You'd reprimand them. So that respect, respect also means being tough and reprimanding and disciplining those kids. And coaches make a difference. You've all had coaches in your lives where you know that those coaches have had impact in your lives. So let's just go through. Before we move on to the next one, and quickly at your table, talk about what's the one point from here that really connects with you. Just 60 seconds at your table. What's the one point here that really connects and explain why to your table?
Never
Every kid has got a different approach. It's a good job to be a coach. You keep moving. Understand the same point. Focus on
Another thing is, these kids are all getting the idea of how things are things, right? Which means that sometimes people might sort of expect that they have to get it immediately. But it takes time.
Anyone want to share up what are some of the key points that you picked up at your table?
Our champ wants to share.
Okay.
It is a good point.
Could you go back to that?
I can. Now you're making me work. I can. What was it?
The first one, value each team member. I believe that one was the most impacting, and that it would make the most difference on a team rather than all the others.
Can you explain why?
Because, I mean, on every team, like it or not, there's going to be those kids that you think are doing great, but then you sometimes don't consider those other kids, little kids, it may not be little, but who are also falling behind them. So I think when you evaluate every single person and work with every single person, it makes a better difference.
Yeah, good point. And what happens, how do you feel when you feel valued? What does that do to you? What does it feel like inside?
Well, it makes you feel good about yourself, uh-huh. But in a bad way, it can also make you feel superior over others.
Okay.
So it just depends how it gets to you.
Yeah. Yeah, and it depends how you react to being feeling valued. Typically when you feel valued, you get filled with confidence. And it's great to play with confidence. There's nothing worse than not playing with confidence. So thank you. Can I move slides now? All right, good boy, thank you. Okay, Jumbo Williams, one of my favorite people on the planet. He coached
Grant Swim.
Herschel Gibbs. Remember, he dropped the World Cup. Yeah. I know that's a tough one. Daryl Cullinan playing some leg spin. Yeah, okay. And then Kepler Vessels as well. So this is what Jumbo says. Now Jumbo was really interesting. I actually was never coached by Jumbo. I worked with him. We taught together. And so I had the privilege of coaching under 9 cricketers with him. So can you imagine, Jumbo coached these guys, and the kind of person he was, he said, I'm done. Those kids are the most important. I want to start cricket at the grassroots. So he started down there. It was the best 2 years of my life to hang out. I just stood there and just watched him deal with these kids. It was remarkable. But now and again, you get these provincial and country players who'd come and who'd be waiting for him at the nets. They'd just come and find him for a quick session. It was remarkable. Sometimes he spent 5 minutes with him, sometimes he spent an hour with him, but very good technically. So a couple of things here. Sorry, I know there's a lot here. Discipline was very key for Jumbo. How are you, what are you wearing? And I know we see the emails going out. Wear your whites, wear the correct clothing. There's a reason behind that, because if you discipline in your dress, it's going to transfer to practice, it's going to transfer to the game. And we know you have to be disciplined when you're playing a game like cricket. So he was very disciplined around that. Cricket is in the head. I love this. It says when you're batting, you take your head to the ball, the foot follows. When you're bowling, your head, he's messed up his language there. But the head follows the path of the ball. So we often see when a kid runs up and bowls, and he bowls all the way down past the second slip, and we say, hey, you know, bowl straight. The kid's got no idea what he's just done. No idea at all. He does it again. No, you've got to bowl straight. Or keep it on the wicket. Trust me, the kid's trying his best to keep it on the wicket. But he has no idea what he's done. So the cricket, John always used to say, cricket's about the head. Whether you're batting, lead with the head. Whether you're bowling, keep your head nice and straight. So, and if he says, if I'm fielding as well, we know that if the head's moving and you're trying to pick up the ball, what happens? Okay, you missed the ball completely. We were seeing in the T20 now. Some huge shots, some amazing shots, but watch the head. The head is always still. It's remarkable. Okay. And he says, of course, psychologically as well. He speaks about encouraging people to believe in themselves, which we just spoke about earlier. Again, knowing each individual, knowing how far you can push them. Don't you notice about all these coaches how they're talking about the relationship first? It's all about the relationship, and then they build in on the skills. But if the relationship isn't there, the child is not going to listen to you. This is really interesting. Encourage each individual to read, to watch cricket, to become knowledgeable about the game. So how do we do that? That's tough in this environment when we're living in an environment that's not conducive. So how do we encourage our kids to actually learn more about the game? Foster a love about the game. Know how the a cricket ball is made, how a cricket bat is made. And this is a key thing as well. Know the laws of the game and how to score. So a very different approach here, isn't it? But Jumbo was a lot about the love of the game and really knowing the game. And as a coach, helping kids to know the background, the history of the game. So that's quite an interesting aspect that he brings in there. Why would you say it's important that they know how to score? Why is that in Ganesh?
Okay, by knowing the rules of the game,
yeah,
it also helps them to know how to take advantage of them.
Absolutely.
Take advantage of them,
yeah,
of the rules, like a no ball, for
yep.
example. I know I can forget everything in the copybook, and I can play a crazy shot because I know for a fact that I'm not going to get out. Likewise, if I know I need to get my best man, and if I want to really strike, rotate the strike, I don't, even if I'm going to give a catch, I'm not going to stand there. I'm going to try to cross the wicket so that I get the next man.
Yeah.
So if I know the rules, I'm always thinking about the game.
Yeah.
Or I used to say, when I used to lead a team, if I know a best man is batting, I want to give that guy a single. I will tell them, you do misfield him.
Yeah.
Just give him a single. I don't want this guy because I know I can't get him out. Let's attack the other guy.
Please get him off track.
So
yeah.
I know that another five balls I have under control. So knowing the rules of the game also helps in certain scenarios.
Absolutely. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, it's a strength. All right. And this knowing how to score is a creating a deeper appreciation of the game as well. I know when I used to go to the Wanderers cricket ground in Johannesburg, we had four kids in the family, we all scored. I've still got scorebooks at home now of my own kids having to score, my girls as well. We go to the MCG every Boxing Day. Whoever played, we didn't care, but all three kids would score. They'd start just by scoring the bowler. And then they'd score the bowler and batsman, and then they'd do, you know, so there are ways of building it up. Again, we're in a different scenario here, but it got them to think deeply about the game. Scoring really gets you deeply thinking about the game. It's remarkable. And it's great with math as well. So
there you go. I think it's a good point, actually. Some of the kids who are, I think in summer camp we should teach them how to score, because that will be really good understanding.
Yeah, it's very important for them to know what the statistics are, how
yeah,
they're built.
Yeah. How
the bowler has
to
keep track. If there is a wide, if there is a bye, who gets the extra?
Yeah.
What goes in the bowler statistics?
Yeah.
What goes in the batsman statistics? Because they don't even keep track of the dot balls.
Yeah.
In the games, they're just playing. Okay, now it's 20 balls, so it's clear. But if you ask a batsman in the middle of a game, what is your target? How many runs did you score? They're just having fun. They're not thinking. The wheels aren't moving, you know.
Key.
Yeah.
That's
a good point. Yeah. No, and along those lines, with our cricket, with Anisa and Nyan, so they're 8 and 9 year olds, they were not allowed to play the first game if they didn't pass the test on how on fielding positions. Because there's nothing more frustrating when you're a coach and you say, you know,
John, I need you to go to mid off and go down to fine leg in the kids' line. What? And not knowing where it is. So eventually you move them there,
yeah,
and they're playing in the covers, and then they start to walk around. The next thing, they're standing next to their buddy and they're having a long conversation. So you're mid off. Where should mid off be? I don't know. So that was really interesting, and so just the basic fielding positions, but they had to know the fielding positions before they played the first game. So something to think about. Right, this is the last one. Okay. So quickly now. Piece of paper. Hopefully if you need more piece of paper, maybe you've drawn them already, but do you mind handing out a few? We're gonna make a little book, a little cricket book. And we're just going to do this for five. Have I got five more minutes, Ganesh?
Absolutely, sir.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. So just follow my instructions. You can do this as well. You're going to make a little book. Are you ready? Alright, and this sounds ridiculous. I know you're thinking, man, are you a grade school teacher? Trust me, there's something crazy about what I'm about to do, because you will look at this little book more than any of your notes you'll ever take. Watch. Okay, so take the piece of paper, fold it this way. So the short way. Good job. The key thing here is to make sure the folds are really, really tight. Because you guys are going to want scissors, and I don't have any scissors. Then you're going to fold it again. Someone at your table is going to get it wrong. Don't laugh at them, don't tease them. So fold it again. Actually, you can tease them a little bit, that's fine. Okay, so now you've got that. Just fold it one more time. So one more time, make sure the folds are really tight. Okay, so you went from you went from that, and then you folded it, and then you folded it, and then you folded it. Okay, so you just, something that looks like that. Good girl. Okay. Now, if you open it so it's like that, you see that? So from the folded line, if you can tear halfway down to the next fold, tear halfway down to the next fold, so you actually end up with something like that. So tear from the fold. So there's the fold. You're tearing from the fold halfway down. Okay, you got that? So that's how you're ending up. If the person next to you hasn't got that, you can point at them and laugh a little bit. Right, then you're going to take both ends and just push it together. And then fold it into a little ball.
Do it again.
What do you mean?
That is the last step.
Okay, there. So you got that? Just help the person at your table. There's always some slow learners, it's okay.
We have
okay. Push. And then it should fold, kind of fold together.
No.
You know, when I do it with third graders, it's a lot quicker. Okay. Alright, so you fold it together. So it actually ends up in a little book like that. Okay. That's it. Yeah. So you got 1, 2, 3, 4.
No, you do it this way.
Yeah. That's it. Okay.
Yeah. Oh.
Okay. Got it?
No.
Okay. So, you've got this little book, most of you. Alright, on the front page, put your name and ACAC or something,
And then on the first page inside, so on the inside corner, please write this down. So on the front cover is your name and ACAC. And then when you open it up on the front cover,
first page you have
right here, and then you can
put your name.
But it is that one, right?
Yeah, it's okay.
So my front cover, and then our inside is a C for cricket. Okay. So, number one. Number one. These are our last, we're going to spell out the word cricket. So taking all this wisdom from all these people, we're going to now spell out the word cricket. So this is going to be our first ACA handbook. Okay. There's going to be a lot more, I'm sure. Okay, so number one, love cricket. So write down, cricket, love and respect the game. So that's your notes from today, love and respect the game. When we talk about loving and respecting the game, we all love and respect the game very, very much. So let's ensure that we hold our students, our players, to that same standard. So write down a few things there. What does it mean for you as a coach to have the kids, the players, love and respect the game? I'll tell you a couple of mine. Number one, wear the correct clothing. Number two, speak with good manners to the umpire. He's the guy I can give you out. Number three for me, very important. When a new batsman comes in, applaud the new batsman. Clap the new batsman in. When the batsman goes out, clap the batsman out and applaud the new one coming in. So those are three important things that I would usually teach a team. Number one, dress correctly. Number two, show manners to the umpire. Please, sir, will you hold my hat? Thank you, sir, as you take it away. Right, I'm bowling right arm over the wicket, sir. So very respectful. And the third one, be respectful of the opposition. Applaud the incoming batsman and the outgoing batsman as well. So those are three things. But think about what are some of the things that you might expect as a coach for your team as they love and respect the game.
Can I add one thing?
Yeah.
Respecting the gear. Most of the kids I've seen during the practice, they get out, they throw the bat. That is totally unacceptable. Totally.
Yeah.
You never throw the ruler at the teacher or throw the pen if you fail in a class, right? So why do it in a cricket game?
Yeah.
Everybody gets out at zero. They have to learn that.
Yeah.
Going back, taking care of the gear. Dads are packing up their gear. That is unacceptable.
Yeah.
You have to teach the kid to be responsible. The helmet, gloves, I mean, there's so many things they can lose.
And it costs so much money.
I never pack my son's gear. You don't have it, you don't get it. That's it.
Yeah.
Lick your gear, haul it to the car, I'll lift the heavy thing, put it in, but I'm not going to carry your gear.
Yeah. I think that's a great point. Number four, you know, under love and respect, are they looking after their gear? Are they respecting the amount of money that that gear costs? So there's some things there. Let's move on because I know I'm going to wrap up in a few minutes. This is a key one for me. R stands for repeat and show for understanding. Repeat and show for understanding. So, an example might be, if I say to a child, so that's the next page. Sorry, yes, that's the next page. Next page is R, repeat and show for understanding. This goes back to, again, the psychology around teaching. We have to show the child what it feels like. So if I'm asking someone to play four defensive, and they're playing their four defensive like that, and I say to them, your bat and your pad need to be together. They have many different interpretations of what that means. I've seen some kids go like this with the wrong leg, or some kids go like that, or put their bat on the other side. For us, it's the most natural thing to do that, because we've played the game. But if we don't actually repeat what we say, remember I said, bat and pad together, and then show them, come and actually physically show them. That's what's great about Khalid Chiran coaching. I mean, he twists their hands, and he pushes their head, and it's very, very, I mean, the kids, when they walk away, they know how they should hold a bat. They really know, you know, and
I mean, it looks funny with him sitting on his chair with his coffee and everything else, and he's like, but there's a reason why he does that. I mean, even to the point of where the fingers should, I mean, it's very detailed, but he's physically showing them. Then I know that the child understands. Then I say, okay, now do it yourself. And then they can do it. All right, now I can see you've got it. But if we just say to the child, bat and pad together, keep your head straight when you bowl the ball, and normally there's five parents shouting that. It's not helpful. We've got to isolate the child, show them again, and then let them show that they know. Before they walk away, they need to show you that they understand. So that's the R, is repeat and show for understanding. And it doesn't matter if it's only a few things. One, if a child walks away from a session learning one thing, it's one thing more than they knew before.
Just on that point, Peter, like,
yes, sir.
Every week a new, the same kid comes in, but he goes back to where he was last week. So it's more of a patience thing where you have to tell them, like, this is where you lost it last week, this is what you have. Like, if the kid is getting hurt in the next game, like yesterday, Zygmunt's kid got it, that kid has to go back and the ball swung in and hit him on the shoulder. Like, I know the kid got hurt, I went there and checked him, like, are you okay?
Yeah.
Then I told him, like, you know, this is what I tell you, if you go back, this is where you want to get to. Mm-hmm. So that repetitive thing has to go on and on and on and on.
On and on and on. And we know that as when we help our children learn to read or to do times tables or whatever it is, that repetition is key. And also remember, it's muscle memory.
Yep.
You know, when I throw you a cricket ball, if I throw AJ a cricket ball, he'll just take it like that, or take it like that. It's what we do, it's just natural, you know. And so, one of the interesting things that I've learned with coaching is that for example, AJ, can I borrow you for a moment? Alright, so if I run up and bowl, AJ is the coach, and I bowl like that. Okay, so what AJ will tell me what's wrong with my action here, AJ.
Keep your head straight, okay. Falling down.
Keep my head straight, I'm falling down. Keep my head straight. So he's absolutely right. Now what he's got to do, he's actually got to manipulate my head. So here's, and don't hit me, just be gentle.
This is opportunity.
Yeah. All right. Okay, so that's the number one thing. He physically shows me what to do. The second thing that we don't do then is that now for AJ to put me in that position that's incorrect. So here I am, I'm more correct here, okay? All right, so put me in that position where I'm incorrect. Put me back again.
Here.
Back again.
Here.
Yeah, okay, thank you. So what is, that's really important, is it's important to show what it should feel like and what it shouldn't feel like. It's a physical game, so it's okay to show. Golfers do that a lot. They say, "There's the golf swing. Feel your follow through there." Okay, well, it shouldn't be there. It should be here. Feel it. They do it constantly, so you can actually start to correct yourself. So,
especially in bowling,
because it's so technical.
So technical.
Yeah. It's the slightest.
That's it.
The slightest tweak. So,
Peter, I have one more thing to share here.
Yeah.
If you watch Sachin or Rahul Dravid play and miss the ball, immediately the next thing is they do the shadow practice of how to play the ball. It's repeat and teach their mind how to play that ball the moment they are missing things. So that's also a repetitive learning experience for
Absolutely.
Them, even at an international level.
Absolutely, and that's why I'm sure all of us had a ball in a sock hanging from a tree. Because in 10 minutes you can play 100 shots. And that's that repetition, so that you know how it feels, as long as you're doing it correctly. If you look out, look out the window and I see Tane just doing anything. Oh, get out there, move them around. Okay, I'll go back up again. Okay, very quickly, the I for cricket is involvement. A really, really important thing with our kids. We say to our kids at cricket training, you're not focused, you're not concentrating enough. That's because they're not doing anything. So high levels of involvement, you should always be looking at your cricket session and saying how many kids are involved at the moment versus how many kids are just sitting around doing nothing. The more kids we've got being involved,
the better. Because cricket is a game where you hang around. That's why kids leave the game, because they find it boring initially. So as we set up training, like that training with the four wickets, there are four kids involved already. You've probably got a few kids fielding around there as well. So how do you keep high levels of involvement as a coach, continuously thinking about that? Am I just hitting to a few kids and I've got 10 kids sitting out? That's dangerous. They're going to get up to some sort of trouble.
Yeah.
And B, they're going to lose interest really quickly. So whatever game you're structuring, and we can get into that another time, what these stations might look like, but it should be high levels of involvement all the time. Are they fielding? Are they hitting? Are they catching? Are they involved in some way or other? So keep that in your thinking all the time, high levels of involvement. This is a really good one. So the next page is C for competition. So even in a catching exercise, there's the top of the group, and they curl around. Here's the bottom of the group. I know self-esteem issues, etc., etc., but it's fine. Okay, when you drop the catch, you move down one. When you catch one, you move up one. So they're competing all the time. A fielding game. Put two goals. And they're rolling the ball at each other. There's a fielding game. There's goals. They're competing. What about when they're playing in the nets? Your job is to we're bowling 10 balls at him. He's got to score 10 runs. Batsman, you've got to score 10 runs. Or batsman, you've just got to stay in. Create a competition with whatever they're doing. Whether it's a personal best competition, whether you're helping them strengthen their hands, so they're bouncing up here. How many can you get? What's your personal best? What about running between wickets? We're going to time you running between wickets. Okay, can you run? How fast can you go? How many have you done in 1 minute? Because there's nothing more boring than teaching running between wickets.
Yeah.
It's so boring. Make it a competition, put a timer on it.
Oh, love it.
They love it. They love it. Because they all, as much as they love each other, they want to beat each other.
Yeah. I used to turn it around in a run-out drill. So four fielders, it's rotating, throwing the ball to each other. The runners have to take four runs or three runs, set a target. Ball goes from mid-on to mid-off to leg side, off side.
And they're
going to
make it.
And they're going to try to keep it. Try to get them out. So they've got to throw accurately, catch accurately while the guys are running.
Yeah.
And then the pair changes, everybody gets to compete, who scored maximum runs. Every time you get out, there's a minus something. Set up interesting drills.
Yeah. Run personal best or versus each other. It's fantastic. Great example. Okay. We've spoken about this one, the KISS principle. These are kids that we're dealing with. So that's our next page. K of the cricket stands for KISS. Keep it simple. Okay? What we mean by that is a number of things. Scaffold is key here. Start like we're building a house. Start down there and we build up to more complexity. But keep it really simple. If we're asking them, so often I hear parents who, when a child plays a beautiful four defensive, people shout and go, turn your wrist. Move it to mid wicket. Angle your bat. There could have been a run there. There's no. The kid's going, man, I'm 10 years old and I've just played a really good four defensive. And now you're saying, you do it, Dad. You try and do that. So if we move from a four defensive to now let's glide the ball down to third man, or let's just quietly turn it to mid wicket. I mean, it's just too much. So when we give the kids information, just give it to them once. You know what? That was great. I love the way you got your head over the ball. Really good stuff. You've got your foot right there. You've got your head over the ball. That's good. If we want to teach them how to drop and run, well, let's scaffold that. Let's start with the four defensive. Then we say, okay, look where your players might, look where the fielders are. Maybe the next week or a few weeks later, we teach them to play with soft hands, whatever it might be. But that's probably only coming in when they're 14 or 15 years old. But how do we keep it nice and simple? The other thing is show, don't tell. We spoke about that, I said that with AJ, did that with AJ earlier. Don't just tell me what to do, I don't know. Help them actually manipulate their hands and their heads and their legs so that you're showing them what to do. Show them what it looks like as well. So they can see, okay, are you copying me? Are you doing the same as me? All right. And then finally on this one, just one voice. I know this is really good with the coaches here. Just the coach should be speaking. When you umpiring in the middle and you watch the confusion of these kids, and it's all meant well. I'm to blame as well. I should yell at my own son, but or encourage someone else. But it's just too much. They don't know what to do. And the stress of these kids on the field, when they should really just be listening to their coach. So I know it's hard. Maybe you have to go and sit in your car or something. But just allow the coach to lead the team. And I think that we've established that culture from early on. So that's really good. We're nearly there, nearly there. Just a really important one. There's discipline around, so the E, eyes on me. Real discipline. So when we're speaking to the kids, make sure they're looking at you. That's how you know they're listening, mostly. Okay? Have them look at you. A, it's polite. And B, it's helping them to focus on you. So I always say, eyes on me. If you're looking at me, I know you're listening. And don't start the conversation. Don't go any further until they've got eyes on you. You're the one speaking. And the same thing if their captain is speaking or if you've asked advice. They should be polite and should be respectful to all be looking at the player or the coach or whoever giving advice. So this is really, their learning will shoot up when they have that level of focus. And the final thing here, my favorite part of the cricket coaching ideas is threes. Coach in threes. The amount of advice that a child has by the time they get into the middle is amazing. So as the coach, what can you tell them that's of utmost importance? So I'll give you an example. When the players go out and they're fielding, I will only give them, and this is part of the KISS principle as well, I'll only give them three things to work on. That's it. As much as I want to tell them there's all this other stuff, three things. So it might be, you know, boys, when we field, or girls, we're going to make sure we make a barrier. That's the number one thing. What are we going to do? We're going to make a barrier. Can everyone show me a barrier? There's the barrier. Awesome. The second thing we're going to do is that we are going to walk in. That's what we're going to do. We're going to walk in. How do we walk in? What do we do when we finish walking in? Oh, we go back to our position. Okay, we're going to walk in. And the third thing, what we're going to do? We're going to back up. So when someone's throwing in, we're quickly going to run around and make sure that we're there to support. And we practice that. That's it. There's all sorts of other things that I could teach them about fielding. But for week in and week out, if they do those three things, when a child goes into bat, we'll probably have a team agreement, which will probably be, let's call. Yes, no, come, whatever the language of that we've chosen. That we're going to do. All right? The other thing, we're going to make sure we back up. And the third thing is, we'll probably be specifically for that player. But it's really, really simple. The bowler as well. Every bowler knows he's got a ball in the wicket, pitch it up, etc., etc. But you know what we're going to do with our bowling today? We're going to make sure that our fodder through is really straight. And then the second thing is, once you've bowled, you're going to get back behind the wickets. That's it, guys. That's fine. Don't worry about how you hold the ball. Don't worry about anything else. Those are the things we're going to do. So it's really, really simple. So when they walk onto the field, it's three things. At the end of the game, whether we won or lost, let's talk about those three things. Those were our goals. How did we go? And have the boys and the girls reflect. So really, really keeping it simple. So, at your table, I know that we've gone on a little bit longer. So, can you just talk to your table people? So, what are the three things that you feel that you can take away? There's been lots of information, but what are the three bits of information that you can take back, and maybe just write them on the front of your book, little book? What are your three takeaways? And then we are done. But what are your three takeaways? Write them down. Share them with your table.
Discipline. Yeah.
and then involvement. A lot of times, oh, queue up, one by one, and they keep moving, and all that. Definitely.
I think routine for everyone.
Yeah,
to keep each other
busy. Yeah, exactly.
Routine involvement, and then...
And competition also, like, you know, we do that, catching and all that, but we never encourage them, like, hey, you're the number one. I mean, yeah.
I think instead of saying number one, we should say, okay, out of five, we took the only
two, three. Yeah,
yeah,
Exactly. You don't want to say that, hey, you're crazy.
And also keep it simple,
so
that
you
like things that you want to learn. I know we try to do 10, 20 things.